Let's take a look at what, in my opinion, are the best Tesseract riffs ever. Honestly, I haven't followed Tesseract much in recent years, but they're a very influential band in the evolution of modern progressive metal. Their first album, One, which these riffs are taken from, is one of the most important djent prog metal albums from the 2010s. The two riffs I'm going to take a look at are from Concealing Fate Part 2, Deception. They happen about 3 minutes and 12 seconds into the song. Tesseract uses 7-string guitars in a very interesting tuning on this song. It goes B-flat, F, B-flat, E-flat, F, B-flat, E-flat. I actually only have my bottom 3 strings tuned like this because that's all the strings that are needed in these riffs and I'm too lazy to change the rest. This first riff is kind of out of character for Tesseract. It's fairly fast and technical, whereas I usually associate Tesseract with more groovy syncopated riffs. I'll show you how to play it and then we'll talk about the rhythm. To play this riff, you'll need to master this 6-note pattern. Play the 3rd fret on the F string, hammer on the 6th fret on the low string from nowhere, then play the open low string. Then you do the same pattern, 1 fret down. Then you play the 1st fret on the low string. This is a little bit tricky. The hammer-ons from nowhere felt really awkward to me at first, but take your time, practice it slowly, and it'll start to feel more natural. Once you have this pattern down, it's just a matter of putting it into the proper rhythmic sequence. This riff is a total of 4 measures of 4-4, which equals 16 quarter notes. This is made pretty obvious by the snare backbeats on beat 3. The riff patterns are grouped as 5-4, 5-4, and 6-4, which also equals 16 quarter notes. The 5-4 is done by playing 2 groups of the 7-note pattern from earlier, followed by a slide to the 4th fret of the low string, and then the 6th fret of the F string. This whole 5-4 pattern gets repeated 2 more times, with 1 quarter note added to the last repetition to make it 6-4. These odd patterns happening against this 4-4 backbeat give this riff a cool polymetric feel. Polymeter is when multiple meters are happening at once. In this case, the 5-4, 5-4, and 6-4 happening against the 4-4 backbeat. This idea of putting odd note groupings against a steady 4-4 backbeat is really the foundation of what we'd call djent. The second riff here uses the same idea, but is considerably more complex. This riff covers a total of 6 measures of 4-4, and the riff patterns are 16th note based. Warning, I'm about to get into some math here. 6 measures of 4-4 equals 96 16th notes, so that's the total this riff will end up taking. The main pattern here is this 4-note sequence. You have the 4th fret on the low string with a little bend, open low string, 3rd fret on the F string, and 1st fret on the low string. These are done as dotted 8th notes, so they equal 3 16th notes apiece. So this 4-note pattern takes up 12 16th notes. Here's the order of this riff. First play the 4-note pattern, then play it again, but this time the last 2 notes are 8th notes instead of dotted 8th notes, meaning they are 1 16th note shorter apiece. This makes the second pattern 10 16th notes long. Then you'll play the 4-note pattern again, and lastly you'll play this 3-note pattern. 2nd fret on the F string, 2nd and 3rd fret on the low string. These are also done as dotted 8th notes, and that equals 9. So we have 4 patterns that go 12, 10, 12, and 9 as 16th notes. This totals 43 16th notes, And remember, we had 96 16th notes to fill up in total. To get to the total of 96 notes, this 43-note riff repeats again, which brings the total to 86 notes and leaves 10 left to fill. This is done by playing the first two notes of the riff again, which is 6 16th notes. That leaves a remainder of 4 16th notes, or 1 quarter note beat, which is done with this little muted figure. This seems incredibly complex when you break it down, but really I'm thinking of this as that 43-note long riff played twice with a few remainder notes tacked on at the end. I would guess that this is how this was written as well. With the polymetric stuff, I'll often come up with a pattern and realize that I need to add a few notes at the end just to have it sync up with whatever the main time signature is, usually 4-4. This riff is not too hard to play technically, but it takes some time to feel rhythmically. I really focused on those two shorter notes in the second pattern, and that seemed to help me play it and feel it more easily. I found if I focused on those two notes that I could lock in with the groove a little bit better. Lastly, I want to talk about this crazy metric modulation that happens right after the second riff. In this riff, we have all these dotted eighth notes, and what happens here is that these dotted eighth notes then become the new eighth note. So they go from taking up 3/16th notes worth of space to taking up 2/16th notes worth of space at a slower tempo. And if I count it out, you'll see how that works. 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, and up. The basic idea is to take a subdivision that's an odd number of notes long, in this case one that's 3/16th notes long, and turn that into your new pulse. So the space that once contained three notes now contains two. 1 and a 2 and a 3 and a 4 and a 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and a 2 and a 3 and a 4 and a 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and. It's extra weird here because the transition in the new slower tempo is 17 eighth notes long. Once again, my guess is that they felt this out and figured out the exact metronome changes later on. It's pretty wild stuff. So there's a deep dive into some awesome Tesseract riffs. These riffs are super fun to play, but even more than that, I think the rhythmic concepts they're dealing with here have lots of useful applications. As always, if you enjoyed this lesson, subscribe, hit the bell notification, like, comment, share, and let me know which riffs you'd like to see me cover in these new riff analysis videos. Till next time, stay proggy.